you morning people.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Good morning, everyone. Praise God. Good to be in church, right? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, y'all ready for the word this morning? Is your heart prepared? You know, you got to come to church ready to receive from the Lord, right? Praise God. Well, I'm gonna jump and get right into this teaching. I'm teaching a series entitled The Fish and the Loaves, and this is as a result of something that the Spirit of the Lord has spoken to my heart concerning this church, that we are to experience things on the level of the fish and the loaves. And so I'm teaching this series, and this is the fourth part on this series. I started it on a Thursday evening, and I'm teaching this series both Sunday and Thursday evening. So I'm just going step by step on Sundays and Thursdays. So if you're not here on Thursdays, not able to make it on Thursdays, we make these available online, or you can get a free CD of it, just so you can kind of keep up with a lot of the stuff, because I can't go back and go, you know, teach it all over again each service, of course. And so I'm very excited what the Lord's doing, specifically what we're talking about here, you know, to experience things in our lives like the example and like the miracle that happened with the fish and loaves is going to require faith on our part, okay? Our part is to have an expectation for things like this to happen in our life. I think what the enemy is after a lot is our expectation. If you think about that, a lot of people expect bad things to happen, but not enough of us expect good things to happen. And we need to expect not only good things to happen, but abundant things to happen. I mean, Jesus Christ said, "The thief cometh but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that you may have life and life more abundantly, to the full, until it overflows." That's an abundant expectation that we can and should have as Christians. Now, don't base your expectation on your life and your life experience, okay? Base your expectation on the Word of God, okay? Because when you do that, you're safe. You're all right. And you can expect something greater tomorrow than you even expected today, because that's really how the revelation in God's Word works in our life. Praise God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We've come here ready to receive and hear of you. Lord, in any area of our life, there's people here that are from all different walks, different backgrounds, different religious backgrounds, different upbringings. Lord, I pray, though, that you would minister truth and revelation to the hearts and minds of every person listening to this message. Lord, in any area of our life where we've been ignorant, where we've been misled or confused or even frustrated about the things of God, I pray for great clarity to come by the power of the Holy Spirit into our lives in Jesus' name. Now, I ask you now, Lord, that you would help me to minister this word with excellence, accuracy, integrity, and boldness in Jesus' name, that signs, wonders, and miracles would follow the word preached. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Praise God. So, we've got to expect things to happen differently in our life. In order for that to happen, we have to be willing to operate on a level of faith in our own life that maybe we're not quite familiar with. Maybe we've never operated like this in our life. We've never believed like this in our life. And I know just saying that kind of can make some people, you know, on edge a little bit, if you will, because you might be thinking, well, you don't know my faith. And you're exactly right. I don't know what kind of faith you're operating in, but I can guarantee you you're not operating on the level of faith that God intends you to operate in. And you could come back and say, well, how do you know that? Because Jesus Christ himself said, the works that I do shall you do, and even greater works shall you do, because I'm going to the Father, right? Right? So if he said the works that he did we can do, I don't see anybody even doing those kind of works much, okay? Some, but not on the level that he was getting results, right? And even greater works, right? So our expectation was set by the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can have an expectation to do the works that Jesus did at even greater. Okay? Now, you don't have to go along in the boat ride. You can stay in the boat with the rest of the disciples, but Peter got out and walked on the water. There's always one in the crowd, right?
Amen.
Peter got out of the boat, didn't he? And he walked on the water. I think this church has water-walking people in it. What I mean by that is you're not just going to be complacent to stay in a place of mediocrity, of what is safe, what is familiar, what everybody else is doing. You're willing to come to a church that's going to teach you faith to do and to believe things like you've never believed before in your life, okay? I truly believe that's why the Holy Spirit brought you here. Hallelujah. Now, I want to talk to you just a few minutes before I even have you turn to a particular scripture verse. And usually we go right to the Word, and we're going to put some verses up here on the screen for you to see. But I just kind of want you to listen just for a few minutes. Now, I realize that what I teach isn't always appealing to the logical mind, meaning it doesn't always, quote-unquote, make sense. But frankly, if you look at the miracles and the things that took place in this book, the Bible, it really isn't meant to just appeal to your logic and what makes sense. The miraculous signs and wonders, the healings, the people being set free. I mean, salvation itself doesn't make sense. You did bad, bad happens back to you, right? No, not with the blood of Jesus. You did bad, you received the blood of Jesus, and now you get good, right?
Lord.
Hallelujah. So the book, the Bible, it's a spiritual book. It's not just meant to be a logical book. And you got to understand that, first of all, because if you sit here and try to analyze the Bible logically, you know, it's really quickly going to take you beyond what makes sense, okay? And so why in the world would we try to live our life only based on logic? We've got to base our life and live our life based on God's Word, based on faith in Him, based on the supernatural. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, it's interesting how many Christians, you know, they enjoy Bible stories. Oh, wow, that's a great story. Read me another one. Noah, wow, what a cool boat. He built a boat. He built a big boat. He didn't even have power tools. What a great story. But they don't believe for miracles in their own life. It's one thing. It's good to believe and enjoy these stories, but come on, what about your life? What about expecting the supernatural in your life? What about expecting something that is beyond the ordinary in your life? Oh, that's great. That guy was crippled for 38 years, and he got up and he walked. Oh, what a great story. What about something you've been dealing with for 38 years? Leaving your life. Amen? Well, it's possible. That's what God wants to do in your life. Amen? So don't just sit there and, you know, participate. Participate with your faith. Amen? Participate in your walk with the Lord. Glory to God. You know, look, here's one. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Oh, yes. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. They don't actually believe that. Because the moment something happens that gets difficult in the life, you know, they go, oh, I'm so overwhelmed. I don't know what to do. What happened to, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me? And you just raise up your hand and you point it in the devil's face and you say, you know what? It may look bad. It may look insurmountable. It may look difficult. But let me remind you that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm not a little weakling. I'm not a little dweeb on this earth. I am a child of Almighty God, and I actually can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, I'm going to preach something here this morning, and it's going to stir you up by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because no sense in just sitting there and watching from the sidelines and being on the bench, right? You might as well just go ahead and get in the game. How about this one? My God shall supply all your need according to His riches and glory. And as soon as they hit financial difficulty, they start whining and crying, and they say, I don't know what to do. I gave this example on Thursday. I said, you know, what if you walked into your workplace on Monday morning and your boss said, you know what, we're not going to be able to make payroll this week. I mean, we're expecting some money to come in, but we're not even sure if it's going to come in. And so we're not going to be able to make payroll, and we don't even think we're going to be able to make it up to you. And you can either leave this job or you stay here, but we don't know what else to do. And you look at them and you put a smile on your face and you say, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. It's okay. Let's get to work. Or do you call your wife, you start crying, start panicking, trying to figure out how you're going to do everything on your own? Say, my God
shall supply
all my need
according to
his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I mean, that separates people who are religious from people who understand the reality of the living Word of God. Hallelujah. Amen. How about this one? If you can believe, all things are possible for those who believe. How about this? We talk about this. I say this and profess this over you every time we leave this church. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You are blessed going in. You are blessed going out. You are blessed in the field. You are blessed in the city. Amen? Everything you set your hand to prospers. And you are the lender, not the borrower. Why do I say that? Because that's what the blessing tells us that we have access to in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 28. Amen? You're blessed. You're blessed with the same as the faithful Abraham. Amen? Hallelujah. How about this one? Who redeemeth my life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with all good things so that my youth is renewed like the eagle. I talked about this on Thursday. Oh, my hip. Oh, my knee. Oh, my back. You going to end there? You going to keep going? Or you going to start getting in your own mouth and let the Word of God fill your mouth and satisfy your life, and you begin to remind yourself, I am strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. You know, for me, you don't have to do this. I talk to my body parts. Amen. I mean, people talk to their body. How come you're so fat? Where did you come from? I talk to my body. Shoulder, work. Function right. Function the way God designed you to function in the very beginning. For my entire lifetime. I tell my body what to do according to God's word. By Jesus' stripes, you are healed. I just tell my body what it is. Now, I know that's a little fanatical. I know not everybody will do that. But, hey, he satisfies my mouth with all good things so that my youth is renewed like the eagle. Psalms 91 says that he shall call upon me. I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen. Now, what we got to decide is what we believe and what we're going to live according to, right? Now, you know, I'm just going flowing here. You know, here's the big hang up. I've heard this argument over and over again. Well, I'm just telling the truth. You know, you say all that stuff, Pastor, but I'm just telling the truth. I'm going to challenge you on that every day of the week. You know why? Because you need to establish in your life what is truth. Amen. Okay? Because if you don't have that God's word is established truth, then you're believing a lie. You see, and you say, well, I'm just saying it the way it is. Okay? And I don't know any other thing than just to say it like it is. I'm just being honest. These are the things I hear. Okay? I'm just being honest. The Bible does say, let God be true and every man a liar. See, there is established truth in this earth. And the established truth that has been given to us is the living Word of God. There's a reason why people have given their life to see that this book is carried on from generation to generation to generation. It's because it holds and embodies the truth for our life. There was a time when God had told the children of Israel, he said, I have given you this land, which was the promised land, right? I have given you this land. This is the land I have given and prepared for you. And it's a land that flows with milk and honey. It was a picture of provision, natural provision for their life. And he said, send out spies that they may go spy this land out, right? They sent 12 spies out, leaders from every tribe of Israel, right? Say leaders. The leadership you follow is very important. The pastor that you sit under is very important. You need to seek God whom's to be your pastor and what ministry that you're to sit under, to hear, and to listen, okay? Because leadership is very important for our lives, right? And so 12 went out, 12 came back. They didn't all come back with the same story. Their stories were the same in this. Truly, it's a land that flows with milk and honey. Meaning this land is what God said it was, okay? But 10 came back and started talking about how big these people were. There's giants here, there's giants there, and he says they're stronger than we are, and we are like grasshoppers in their sight. You see, it wasn't that they were so big, it's that their image was so little. 2 came back, Joshua and Caleb, and said this, we are well able to go up at once and possess it. Now, they were the same size and stature as the other 10, okay? But they had an image that was that caused them to speak faith out of their spirit and out of their heart that said, we can go up at once. The only way they got that image is from what God said to them, this is their land. And you know what? The 10 that brought back the report about the land that flows with milk and honey, but then those 10 said, these giants are here, these giants are there, and we are grasshoppers in their sight, you know, that they're going to, they'll eat us up, basically, is what they're saying. That, by all practical purposes, was a very factual report, was it not? It was a fact there were giants in that land. It was a fact that they were much bigger than them. It was a fact that, physically speaking, they were much stronger than they were, okay? But it wasn't the truth. Amen. Because God had already told them, this is your land. Am I right? Is that right? I mean, I know where they put it up there. Thank you very much. Okay. And you know what report the Bible says they brought up? That report, which was a factual report, that people today would say, I'm just saying the truth, Pastor. I'm just saying it like it is, Pastor. I'm just being honest, okay? I'm just being honest right now. Oh, you weren't honest before? Okay, I won't go there, all right? You know what the Bible says about that report? It was an evil report. I said it was an evil report. The Bible says it was an evil report. See it? And they brought up an evil report. Say evil report. Now why was that evil? I mean, it was the facts. People today would say it's the truth. It wasn't the truth. Because the truth was, those inhabitants wouldn't eat them up. Because God already said he'd deliver it to them. That it was their land, right? All I'm establishing is, you need to identify and establish in your own heart, in your own mind, what is true. That is so important for your life. Because once you establish that God's living word, it embodies and it holds truth for your life, now you begin to build your faith in your life on what is true. Okay? All that was the appetizer. Go to Luke chapter 15, please. We're going to go to verse 11. Praise the Lord. Say this. Faith worketh by love. Now, a lot of people know faith works by love. In Galatians, gentlemen, if you want to throw that up there, you can see. If you're taking notes, write this down. Galatians 5:6 says that neither circumcision availeth or anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith, faith which worketh by love. Okay. Now, sure enough, we are to operate in the love of God, right? Christians, we're supposed to be lovely. Not always so lovely, but you're lovely. You're supposed to operate in love, right? By the way, I want to say, I did notice, I had to notice that a meet and greet was a little bit different today than it was last Sunday. I think you guys listened to the end of that sermon last week. Remember that? I get up here, I get going, I get flowing, I don't remember everything I say, okay? I was at lunch last week, and they're like, man, you're the only pastor that says you don't even like some of the people at the church. All right, if you were here, easy, all right, I love you. I'm commanded to love you. I don't have to be your buddy, but I'm commanded to love you. I love you, right? I mean, there are some people you just don't like, right? Don't act all holy, all right? Come on. I mean, you love them, but you just don't like them. I guess you don't invite everybody over to your house. Yeah, I'm getting in hot water already. I can tell I get some looks. Some people can't even handle this kind of talk, you know? It's all right. Faith worketh by love, doesn't it? Now, this love, our faith doesn't only work and operate by us loving God or loving other people. Our faith is to work on a level, for it to work on a level that God intended for it to work on, we must have a revelation of our Heavenly Father's love for us. Say, faith works by love. Again, we're supposed to be lovely. We're supposed to operate and function in the love of God, right? But this isn't what causes necessarily our faith to work alone. Because if you don't have a revelation of the love of the Father for you, I don't believe your faith will work and operate on the level that it was intended to work and operate on. So here in Luke chapter 15, it's a very familiar passage here, but it says to illustrate this point further, Jesus told the story. I'm going to read quick. You okay with that? You can follow along. We got it on the screen. They'll try to keep up. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, I want my share of the estate now before you die. So his father agreed to divide his wealth between the sons, between his sons. Say both of them. Okay, so both of them got the inheritance, right? Now, don't forget that, okay? A few days later, the younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land, and there he wasted all his money on wild living. About the same time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him out into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, Senses, hallelujah. You know, if you got somebody that's not living for the Lord in your family, you pray that they come to their senses. Amen. Amen? He said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have enough food to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. Now look at what he does, verse 18. He begins to rehearse what he's going to go say. You ever done that? Well, I know what I'm going to say to him. And you're sitting here and you get it all ready. Right? You're planning it out. You're thinking about what you're going to do. He says, I know. I will go home to my father and say, Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer to be worthy to be called your son. Take me on as a hired servant. Okay, so he rehearsed it, got it all worked up. He knew what he was going to say, and he begins to go home. He returned home to his father, and while he was still a long way off, say a long way off. He says, a long way off, his father saw him coming, filled with love and compassion. Filled with love and compassion. That is so important. I'm talking about how your faith works by love. And this, that your faith working in love is a revelation that God loves you. Okay? Filled with compassion, he stood on the front porch of his house, folded his arms, tapped his foot, and said, about time, you little nasty boy. Come here. I knew this day would come. I knew exactly what you were going to do. Why don't you just go ahead and start crawling? Oh, wait. No, that's not what my Bible says. Not what your Bible says either, right? Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son. Embraced him. He was feeding the pigs and kissed him. Right? Look at the next thing he does. His son said to him, here it is. He rehearsed this. He had it all worked up. Father, I'm just going to say it like he might have said it. Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you. And I'm no longer to be worthy to be called your son. You know, the voice goes up sometimes. You know, his father didn't even respond to him. He didn't want to hear it. His father said to the servants, not his son, quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. You know, that's a picture of righteousness. That's a picture of the righteousness of Christ Jesus. We've been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Righteousness, a robe is a picture of the righteousness of God, and he is the finest righteousness that we could ever embrace and receive in our life. Right? Get a ring, put it on his finger. What's that shows? That shows that he's part of this family. I'm not accepting you as a servant in this house. I'm accepting you for who you are as my son. Right? Put sandals on his feet. And they killed the fatted calf. Verse 24 says, for this son of mine was dead, and now he has returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So the party began. Meanwhile, dun, 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 the older son was in the field working. When he returned home, he heard the music and dancing in the house. And he asked one of the servants what was going on. The older son, say the older son. Now remember, the father divided the inheritance to both the sons, right? He says, I'm paraphrasing this, what's going on here? And the servant says, your brother's back. He said, your father killed the fatted calf. We're celebrating because of his safe return. It's his brother. It's his brother. Isn't that exciting? I have seen this. I have seen this same attitude in people. People who one person has been going to church, doing what they should be doing, on and on and on. And then one of their buddies was in church, left church, act like a fool, did all this stuff. They come back to church, and then they're crossing their arms like, yeah, get in line, buddy. Get in line. Because I've been here, and I've been living for God. And, you know, you got to start down at the bottom of the totem pole because I've been here, and I've been here the whole time. See, this is pride. The older brother, you'd think he'd be happy, but he was angry, and he wouldn't even go in. But once again, his father, say his father. Remember, he's filled with love and compassion, right? For both the sons. Came out and begged him to come in. Right? Because he doesn't want anybody missing out. He wasn't trying to shortchange the older brother. He divided his inheritance to both of them. The party was for both of them. It's a family party. He didn't say, hey, you can have some hors d'oeuvres, but you're not having the fatted calf, all right? That's only for the brother, you know, that was gone. This party was for both of them, right? He said, but he replied, all these years. Now he's the whiny baby. All these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing that you told me to do. Hey, this righteousness, this access, this inheritance, this abundance isn't for people who just slave for God. He wasn't looking for a servant. His son came back and said, just make me a servant. He didn't make him a servant. He's a son. Amen. Yeah, when your son comes back, you know, after squandering his money and on prostitutes and all this, you celebrate by killing a fatted calf, and he's all upset. His father said to him, "Look, dear son, you've always stayed with me, and everything I have is yours." You got to understand, you see the attitude in this? Do you see the heart of this father in this? Here's how I would have said it. Knock it off. Stop acting like that. Are you kidding me? Be excited your brother's back. All that I have is yours. Get in here. Let's celebrate together. Right? That's how I act. I don't know. You might be a little more gentle than I am, but... It's hard. It's hard for you to use your faith if you think that God's mad at you, if you think that God's disappointed in you, if you think that God's trying to teach you a lesson through some bad circumstances and bad situation or sickness. And it's hard for you to use your faith if you're trying to earn God's grace and earn His favor and earn His blessing. That's not how it comes. We receive everything we get from God is by faith. And faith worketh by love. And if you don't have a revelation of the love of God in your own heart and in your own mind, it's going to be very difficult for you to receive anything from God, especially with your faith. Amen? Listen to John chapter 16, 27. For the Father Himself loveth you. Say it with me. For the Father Himself loveth me, right? 1 John 4:16 says, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Do you see? God loves you. Say, God loves me. Go to 2 Corinthians 4:13. Get something out of this? All right, stay with me. Glad you're here. Praise the Lord. We looked at this Thursday. I'm going to look at it just quickly. Just want to touch on it Sunday here, just so you can see this. Some people, they just beat, you know, the devil beats you up. People beat their own selves up. You know, I'm not good enough. I don't have that kind of faith you're talking about, Pastor, you know. I'm not anything special. I hardly go to church. I hardly do this. I hardly do that. Hey, you got faith. Come on now. Start. Go with what you got, right? 2 Corinthians 4:13, look at this. We, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. Say, I have. The same spirit. Of faith. I'd say, of course we do, because we have God's spiritual DNA on the inside of us. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 11, it's the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us, and he that raised Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body by his spirit that dwelleth in you, right? 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, know ye not that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost, or the temple of God, that the spirit of God dwelleth in you, right? Say, the spirit of God dwells in me. Now, here's something that I hear. Well, Pastor, I just don't know what to do anymore. Well, don't ask me what to do. Ask the Spirit of the Lord what to do. I don't mean to be insensitive about it. I mean, I'll help you best I can. But ultimately, the only thing I can give you is what God gives us anyway. Right? Now, if you're tempted to ask your friends, and, you know, I see this a lot on social media, looking for recommendations. I kind of always laugh when I see that. That's fine if you do that. You're like, oh, he must have read my post. He's talking about me. I didn't read your post. I just see him. I don't even pay attention that much. Easy, okay? But what's interesting, in a serious note, is that people make serious life decisions based on more the opinions of others rather than the opinion of God. Go to James chapter 1, verse 5. Let's look at this real quick. What do you think I should do? 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 Okay, I don't care if you want to ask 100 people what to do. But don't make your decision just based on what people say to do. Because 100 people can miss it. But I know one who can never miss it. And that's God. Amen? James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, we've all lacked wisdom. There's more wisdom. Amen? If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men. How many men?
All.
That's all mankind. That's you and me, right? Say all men.
All men.
Say it again. All men.
All men.
Say that means me. Okay, so if you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. So there's asking involved, right? Well, I just don't know what to do. Well, then ask him. It's amazing how many people just don't ask. They cry about it, they squall about it, they complain about it, but they just don't ask. I'm guilty of it too. I've been frustrated about things and like tried to figure things out, and then I get to a point, I'm like, this is so stupid. I talk to myself like that. This is so stupid. I've complained, and I haven't even asked the Lord what to do about this. Okay, I'm probably the only one, but that's okay. I can handle it. Let him ask of God that giveth to all men stingily. No, liberally. That means he doesn't give you like a crossword puzzle and you have to figure it out, okay? It's not a Scrabble game with God. He's going to give you the wisdom that you need, liberally, abundantly. He upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. It shall be given him. It what? Wisdom. The wisdom you asked for. It shall be given you. Stop saying you don't know what to do. But let him ask how? Well, there's that word faith that I'm teaching on, right? Let him ask how?
In faith.
Going back to the example of the fish and the loaves, here's 5,000 men plus women and children, about 15,000 people. They're hungry. We know Jesus said, I don't say but what I hear my Father say and do but what I see my Father do, right? So the disciples said, send them away so they can go into the villages and get some food, get something to eat. It's getting late in the day. Jesus says, don't send them away, right? Remember that? Don't send them away. Well, how are we going to feed them? One of the disciples said, man, if we worked for months and months and months, we couldn't even earn enough money to buy the food to feed all these people, right? Now, I'm way ahead of myself. This is like page 20. I'm on like 2 or whatever. I don't know. Don't matter. But what did Jesus tap into? The wisdom of God. Say the wisdom of God. And one of the disciples said, we have a little boy here with a few fish and a few loaves, right? But what is that amongst all these people, right? Didn't one of the disciples say that? Yeah, what is, I mean, this isn't enough. And we got a few little fish and loaves, but that's it. But the wisdom of God knew what to do with the little they had. Right? And that wisdom was poured out liberally. And the fish and the loaves multiplied liberally. Am I right about it?
Yes.
He says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything from the Lord. Wow. There are a lot of people that don't think they're going to receive anything from the Lord. And that's exactly why. Because they waver. Woo! Ouch or amen. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. I see more instability in the earth and among people today than I've ever seen in my lifetime. I truly believe it's because there's a lack of the wisdom of God operating in the lives of people. People that operate in the wisdom of God are very stable people. Unstable people are people who are double-minded. Whew. Unbelief is a product of a lack of faith. A lack of faith is a product of a lack of spiritual knowledge. Have you ever done or performed a particular task that you've developed and become skilled in, and you know how to do it? And when you know how to do it, have you ever had somebody come watch you do what you do, and they're almost in awe? They go, how do you know how to do that? Or how do you do that so proficiently, right? Now, we all operate and you know, probably have all some professional skill or just good at whatever, you know? I mean, I just looked at Pete. Pete, raise your hand over there. Pete, first time I knew Pete for a number of years, and one day I saw him step on a baseball field. That guy, I was so blown away at his skill at the sport of baseball. It was so fun to watch him. My mom used to come watch the games, not to watch me, to watch Pete. But he was fun to watch. He's on my team. He was fun to watch because he was skilled. He knew how to play that game. He knew when to swing the bat. He knew how to position it and how to do what he did. Offense and defense, very skilled at the sport. You know, when you know the love of God and you become so skilled in the revelation of it, you can do things and other people will be like, how do you believe like that? How do you use your faith for that? Oh, I could never do it. Because you know it. You become so acquainted with the love of God in your life. You just know that you know that you know that you know that you know that your Heavenly Father is filled with love and compassion. Yes. And you stop acting like a servant and you start acting like a son of God. That's what God's after. He's not looking for servants. He's looking for sons. I'll say this, sons and daughters, right? As sons and daughters, we serve our Heavenly Father, but we are not looked at as servants. A servant has a different mentality than a son or daughter who serves. Hallelujah. Go with me to Mark chapter 4, verse 35. And we'll look at the effect here just for a few minutes of unbelief. Praise God. Because unbelief has an effect on our life and on our faith. Many times we're in unbelief when we don't even know it. You know that? When a person gets desperate, their natural reaction is to complain to someone or to the Lord about their situation. Let me say that again. When a person gets desperate, I don't mean desperate good, I mean desperate bad, if that makes sense, you know? When they get in a desperate, dire situation, there is a tendency among people to blame God. You know, I just don't know why God's doing this. Well, I just don't know why this. I just don't know why that. And we might get into this a little bit more, and I'd like to incorporate the teaching in the book of Job himself in this, because there's some things in there that, it's good. All right, Mark chapter 4, verse 35, and the same day when the evening was come, he said to them, let us pass over to the other side. Say that with me. Let us pass over to the other side. Now, I made this point in first service. You can do with it what you want. This is what I do. When we go on vacation, I just say this every time, I think pretty much every time we go. I don't care if I'm driving in a vehicle or flying in an airplane or whatever it is. I said, Lord, thank you that we go over to the other side, all the way to our destination, from point A to point B, with no interruptions, with no accidents and no incidents. That's what I say, okay? I just proclaim it before I ever leave. Okay? Jesus did it, and that's why I do it. Okay? He clearly told them, let's go over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as in the ship, and there's also with him other little ships, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat in the ship, so that it was now full. And when he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow, they waked him, and they said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Right? See, the tendency is, when the pressure gets on, when people get desperate, is to blame God. Don't blame God. Don't blame him. He's not the cause of your problems. He's the solution to the problem. Okay? He's the answer to the problem. And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, good thing you woke me up. You could have woke me up when the water started coming to the boat rather than when the boat was already full. Is that what he said? No, it's not what he said. He said, why are you so fearful? Look at this. How is it that you have no faith? That's a rebuke, people, in case you didn't know. These guys have been following him around. He's been teaching faith, preaching faith, demonstrating faith, and he's fully expecting them to operate in faith in the middle of their desperate situation. He didn't talk about his faith. Jesus didn't talk about how great his faith was, did he? He said, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Why did he say that? Because he fully expected them to use their faith in their desperate situation. He's teaching them how to live by faith. He knew he wasn't going to be with them forever. So he's got to impart into them and teach them now how to begin to teach and operate in faith. Amen. And he arose, he rebuked the wind, on and on. He said, fearful. Look at this. And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Right? Listen, there's only one manner that the wind and the waves will obey, and it's a manner of faith. You know what manner means? I looked it up. A way, a mode, a style, an approach, a technique, a methodology, a routine. Say a routine. That's why he said, we're not told in the Bible, every once in a while, you're going to have to use faith. No. Live by faith. Walk by faith. From faith to faith. Right? A routine, a demeanor, an air, an aspect. This is my favorite one here. An attitude. Behavior or a conduct. We can and should have this manner of faith. What manner of man is it that the wind and the waves obey him? The only manner wind and waves will obey is someone that is demonstrating an air about themselves, an attitude about themselves, an approach, a technique, a routine, a behavior, a conduct of faith. Faith has all those things. Do you hear me? In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, it says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Say, let. Key word in the verse. Right? Now, you've been given the mind of Christ, but you have to let that mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I like what the New Living Translation says. Look at this. It says, you must have the same attitude that Christ had. They said, what manner of man is this? They could have said it like this. What attitude of faith does this guy have? What attitude, that even the wind and the seas obey him? Now, I'm not talking cockiness. I'm not talking arrogance. This is a humble attitude. But when it comes to the devil, we don't back down. When it comes to desperate situations, that's not the time to back down. That's the time to get bold. He stood up in the bow of the boat and he rebuked the wind. That's boldness, people. Look at this. Go to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 12. I'm telling you, there's an attitude about your faith when you're facing desperate situations. And that attitude isn't a whiny baby crying, begging God for his help. Oh, what are we going to do? Boat's full of water, my life's falling apart, and this is happening and that's happening. God. Hey, you're not approaching God like he tells you to approach him. I had one guy said, he came to me, and I know he meant good, I know he meant well, and he said, you know, Pastor, I cried all night, and I couldn't cry anymore, and I'm not trying to pick on him, he actually gone home to be with the Lord now, and he said, I cried so much, my entire pillow was soaked with tears. Now he has to wash his pillow. Trying to get my breakthrough. I know he meant well. You've heard this too. Okay? But it's really not scripturally sound. Well, the Bible says we cry out to him. Yeah, that cry out is, God! Thank you, Lord, that you are working on my behalf. Amen. Thank you that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Thank you that this is the victory that overcomes the world, even my faith. Yes. Am I right about it?
Yes.
Let's look at Ephesians 3:12. Because of Christ, and our faith in him. Say, my faith.
My faith.
So because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come like a whiny baby, cry on my pillow all night till the pillowcase is soaked. No, boldly and confidently into the presence of God. Where is the wisdom at? It's in the presence of God. Where are the answers at? In the presence of God. Where is your help? In the presence of God. How do we come to the presence of God? Oh, come on. You can't even say boldly. I'm going to give you a second chance on that one, okay? God's a God of second chances, so how do we come into the presence of God?
Boldly.
Yeah, baby. So talking about, you're going to leave here remembering that right here. Somebody's going, Mom, Dad, what church did you bring me to? I don't know what's going on here. We were never that loud in the church we were raised in. Come on. Hebrews 4:16. I don't want you to see it once. I don't want you to see this word boldly. Well, boldly, one verse. Oh, there's more. And there's more. So, Hebrews 4:16. So, let us come
boldly
to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive mercy and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. That's where the help is, at that throne of grace. But you don't come to the throne of grace with your head down and say, Father, make me as one of your hired servants. That didn't work. That didn't work, did it? He said, go get the best robe in the house and put it on him. Didn't he? He said, get a ring, put it on his finger, put shoes on his feet, fill the fatted calf. We're about to have a party. That's boldness, people. Do you see the fun in that? I mean, Christianity's fun, people. And when you know you can come boldly to the throne of grace, amen, you can go there with an expectation, right?
Right.
Glory to God. I don't care how desperate your situation looks like. You're never going to get God to move independently from what his word has already established. And his word is established that says we come boldly to the throne of grace, right? And we've got to come boldly, and we come boldly dependent, absolutely dependent on his word. Joshua and Caleb said, we are well able to go up at once and take it. Not based on what it looked like, based on what God had already established by saying, this land is yours. I have given you this land. Look at Proverbs 28:1. The wicked run away when no one is chasing them. But the godly are
bold.
The godly are bold as a lion. Come on, right? Well, you know, I'm just a Christian, and you know, I don't want to offend anybody with my faith. I don't want to force my faith on anyone. I don't want to offend anybody with my faith. Acts 4:29. Oh Lord, hear their threats and give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. That's good news. Acts 4:31, after this prayer, the meeting place shook, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they preached the word of God with
boldness.
Acts 9:28, so Saul stayed with the apostles and went all around Jerusalem with them, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. How did he preach? Obviously, he was getting a little bit of effect there, wasn't he? Right? Acts 19:8. Then Paul went to the synagogue and preached boldly for the next 3 months. Listen to this: arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. He was rattling their cage. He was challenging the very establishment of the religious people and hierarchy of the day. Romans 10:20 says, and later Isaiah spoke boldly for God, saying, I was found by people who weren't even looking for me. I showed myself to those who weren't even asking for me. The prophet Isaiah was saying, you know what? We're cutting a new path here. Right? Have you ever, I mean, I've done this, maybe a lot of you haven't. If you've ever had to cut a new path through the woods, I mean, if there's briars and vines and all kinds of stuff, you don't just like, I mean, you got to go in there just a swinging. And you're just clearing out to get a path through. Right? When we bought a piece of property years ago, and we were looking for the survey marks, right? The monuments and pins and stuff like that. And it's completely overgrown because it was like 40 or 50 years when they did the survey prior to that. Well, you know, so I got to get a clearer line of sight so I can try to figure out where the boundary lines, property lines are on this thing. Plus, I was going to hire a survey company. And, you know, sometimes if you do some of the work for them, catch a little bit of break, okay? We don't just go out there and go, a little branch here, you know. No, you clear a path. That's what the prophet Isaiah was doing by the Spirit of the Lord. He was going to people that weren't asking for him, didn't even want him to come talk to him. But he was boldly declaring the word of the Lord. Sometimes you need to go into your office place, in your workplace, in your communities, even in your own families sometimes, and you need to boldly proclaim the word of the Lord. Just take someone with some faith to stand up in the face of a desperate situation. And man, if somebody's hurting, and somebody's gotten a bad diagnosis, and you stand up and say, you know what? It ain't the end. It ain't over. God's going to have the last word here. And you might think, well, you know, nah, I don't want to get their hopes up. They need their hopes up. More importantly, they need their faith up. And sometimes it takes you to do it. Stand your feet, please. Glory to God. Let this mind, let this attitude, let this demeanor, let this, right, this way of doing be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's boldness, people. That's boldness. I know it isn't always the most popular. I know it's not politically correct, but boldness changes people's lives. You know, I thank God for bold men and women who've taught me the gospel and the word from the time I was a little child and in little classrooms like this, even smaller. I mean, I had a Sunday school teacher. You know, anybody not feeling good? And, you know, little kids would raise their hand. All right, we're going to pray. And she'd get there and start praying in the Spirit and praying and believing God. And, man, kids get healed. Lord. I had a youth minister, still friends with them today. They're still pastoring today. Same thing. I'd bring my buddies from high school over there. Their eyes would get about this big. That couple is filled with the Holy Ghost. Lord. They would teach us as teenagers boldly. And you know what? It made an impact in our life. And there's a young man that I met in the eighth grade that didn't go to church, believed in God a little, and he was here this morning in first service. Yep. You know what I did? I took him to youth group with me when we were about 13 or 14 years old. Man, they started praying in spirit and tongues in there. Freaked his Catholic eyes out of his skull. His mama told him, "You ain't going back to that church." I saw his mama 2 weeks ago at Chili's. She said, "Is he going to your church?" I said, "Well, he's getting close." She goes, "I sure hope he goes." Yep. He's actually been here 2 weeks in a row now. Glory. There's something about boldness. There's something about that confidence of faith in God's word. It's not in ourself. This confidence isn't in ourself. Confidence in itself doesn't do it. Boldness in itself doesn't do it. It's a boldness and it's a confidence in the living word of God. That truth has been established. And when you know truth, you can boldly proclaim truth. Okay? Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for helping me to minister this word today. Lord, I pray for the hearts and the lives of every person here. I pray that even today, that we walk out of here with a different attitude, a different boldness about our faith, and about our life, and about our walk, and about your word, that we leave here with a desire to live according to the established truth of the living word of God for our lives. We no longer are willing to accept the status quo, what someone else has said about us, or how we've even thought about ourselves. But we're willing to readjust the identity of who we are as a child of God. And that you love us, filled with love and compassion. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're here and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, prayer couples, please come up here quickly. If you don't know that you know that you know that you're saved, that you're a Christian, if you don't know that, as I dismiss, I ask you, please step out of the aisle. If people are going to funnel out, you come forward. Let us pray with you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Or if you'd like to be filled with the Holy Spirit, let us pray with you concerning that. Or if you'd like prayer in any area of your life, maybe you're dealing with something, going through something, or you know someone who is. We are here to join our faith with your faith for your miracle. God bless you. You're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Blessed going in, blessed going out. Everything you set your hand to prospers. You're good looking. You're dismissed. Thank you.
Character.